Click the bell icon to get latest videos from Ikeda.
Hello friends. Today I'm going to discuss on a very simple and a very small and a very tricky topic, which is some abbreviations or terms that we use in our emails unknowingly. And it's because we're so much used to our chat process that we use certain things in our mails too. It becomes like a culture to add the same things in our emails, and which becomes a challenge for us to have a professional email sent to professional people, because they come with their own concepts of imagination of what we've put and how we should put it across. So I would help you to get yourself in a better position of understanding of some abbreviations and terms which we are not supposed to use in an email. Number one, of course, ASAP. So when we write ASAP, it is not really for the email. We must write ASAP for our chat. So when we are writing an email, it has to be put as soon as possible. First major thing where people feel that, you know, putting shortcuts will help them save time. But yes, which does, but not for an formal email. The next is FYI, so which is for your information. This doesn't usually require a response. It is an informational purpose only. So when we put certain abbreviations like FYI, we have to understand that we are not requesting, or we do not really require a response. It's just for the information. So we can put these kind of abbreviations. COB, which is close of business at 5 p.m. So when we say our business shuts down at 5, or you know, our office shuts down at 5, we can use abbreviations like COB 5 p.m. People who are into formal email etiquette would definitely understand what we mean to say. For me, if you ask me, I think it's important to write the full form, but yes, we can use certain abbreviations, but limit yourself to it. RSVP. Now, this is very important. Many people do not really understand what is RSVP. RSVP actually is a French phrase, which has come from a French phrase which says responsa illustrant, which means please reply. So RSVP means a reply that you want from a person. We'll see a form of RSVP of, you know, maybe an invitation letter, how it looks like when it is an RSVP. This signifies a commitment. It signifies that yes, you are committed to something like this and you will be there up to that mark. So that is why we used RSVP. Regrets only is also one of the abbreviations that we use, where you only need to respond if you are not attending. So suppose if there was a function and you're not able to attend, this is what you can put as regrets only. So it shows that you couldn't attend it and you have high regrets for it. Let's go to the RSVP slide behind me that you can see, which is a simple invitation slide. So when you say please reply by August 19, this is what you want the reply, and this RSVP means you're asking for reply. Name, your name, number of people who are going to come in. So you can write Mr. So-and-so, I will attend. I'll be, or Mr. So-and-so, I'll be not able to attend. So you can either tick, or either you can write, you know. So I think that you can tick it. So we have to say that I will be able to attend or I'll not be able to attend. So a tick there. Please indicate your entry preferences. So whether you want to have chicken or whether you want to have pasta. So this is something that an RSVP could do. So this is a kind of formal invitation where you are understanding, or you know, you are expecting a commitment from someone that they would come, so that you know how many people are coming and it's easy for you to make certain arrangements. And whether your preferences is chicken or pasta, it makes their life easy to understand what do you prefer to eat. Now this invitation is sent out either for wedding invitations. This can go as a formal meetup invitation. You know, many offices have corporate events. This can go out for a corporate invitation, event invitation, lot of things. So RSVP basically is where you really need a reply on who's coming, who's not coming, what's happening, right? So this is what you can have. Now, besides this, there are of course some more abbreviations and terms that I would like to discuss. First is exclamation marks. So if you see on the slide, exclamation marks, why do you think can they be used or they shouldn't be used. So in an academic or professional email, you want to avoid exclamation marks because you need to avoid it because they can misinterpret the statement as an angry, immature or too enthusiastic. So these are some, concepts or terms that people would label your email as. They would either say you're very angry or they would either say you're really excited. It depends on the subject of your email. And it would also say whether you're immature. You don't know where exactly the exclamation has to be put. Exclamations can be made when you're praising someone. So like you said, great job, well done. So this is something where you can put your exclamations in an email. That's the best way to put it up as an exclamatory mark. But I don't think anything else would represent the correct form of you putting down an exclamation on any other sentences. So I think only an appreciation or a praising statement would go well with an exclamatory mark. Now, while you're explaining an absence, what do you think can we do for when you're explaining your absence? So do not ask a leave or ask if it's okay that you will be absent. So many a times we go ahead and say that, I have a family function and so and so on so and so day. And is it okay if I don't come on that day? That's a wrong way of asking a leave or an absence. Of course, no one is okay with it. That's the only reason we are asking for it. So we can put it up if you are sick, simply inform your boss or any of the person who needs that information that you're not feeling well or under the weather. So you're not feeling well or the weather is not right. It is unnecessary to include details of your sickness. So many a times we just go on telling our sickness and symptoms that so yesterday because of the heavy rains I felt sick and now I'm sneezing continuously. He's not really interested. The main matter of the fact is that you'll not be able to come. So we can simply say that I am not well and because I'm unwell, I don't think I'll be able to come so and so, rather than asking, is it okay? So this is some things that we need to keep in mind mailing someone certain context of how I can request for an absence. Scheduled doctor dentist appointments are not considered as an excused absence. So if you say that I have an appointment with the doctor of so-and-so, that doesn't mean that you're excused of work, or that doesn't mean that that is appreciated, or maybe many a times you might get a reply saying not accepted. So never ever ask something which is not relevant for anyone to tell you a yes or no. You can be your own decision maker, and at that particular point of time, very politely, just inform that why are you not coming and what is the main reason for your absence, right? So these are some major terms that go wrong while we are writing an email, and that's why we feel, oh my God, my boss is so rude. He's got back to saying to me that it's not acceptable because we've not asked it right. So friends, I thought these were some important abbreviations and terms which I thought that every day we, have these small issues where we tend to make mistakes and then we think of why didn't it go right, because according to me it was supposed to be right. So now after seeing the video, you might get a little help on how to be in a better position to put up your terms, your abbreviations in place. So thank you for watching this video. Please stay tuned to Ikira and keep subscribing to our channel. Thank you.